So now you'll have to bear with my English. I'm sorry I can't be there with you this morning. I know this is a really historic meeting, and I'd love to be in Cuba and visiting your beautiful country, maybe sometime down the road. But I'm delighted to be able to speak with you through the miracles of modern technology. And what I'd like to talk with you about this morning is why it makes such good sense to integrate spirituality into mental health care. My focus is going to be on an empirically based rationale here, which is a rationale based on solid research. So I'm going to offer some research-based reasons why the kind of work we've been involved in makes really, really good sense. And let me preface this by noting that an important shift in our field has been taking place for the last few decades. We're beginning to shed light on some of the deepest and most elusive dimensions of behavior, the spiritual dimension in particular. We're just getting started, and questions continue to outnumber answers by far, but we're making good progress. Even so, this is a very challenging domain. And this morning, I'd like to talk a little bit about why integration of spirituality into mental health care is really challenging, and then offer a rationale for why it does make such good sense. Let me start by noting that historically there have been important tensions between spirituality and mental health. The health and human sciences have been reluctant to integrate spirituality into their work, and the reluctance has several roots. First of all, in an attempt to establish itself as a hard science, the human sciences historically avoided anything that hinted of superstition or magic, including religion. It's true the picture has begun to change today, and researchers and practitioners are now turning their attention to practices that have deep roots in religion and spirituality, such as meditation and the virtues of forgiveness and gratitude. But you'll see that researchers do still tiptoe very gingerly around the underlying religious and spiritual meanings of these practices. A second reason for the tension between spirituality and mental health is the fact that our leading figures, people such as Freud and B.F. Skinner, went beyond skepticism about spirituality to really blatant antagonism, equating religious practices with pathology. For instance, in this overhead, this slide, we see that Freud really had some issues or a blind spot when it came to religion. He spoke of religion as a source of pathology, a source of delusion, a childlike regression to a period in life where a child depends helplessly on the parents. That attitude has in some ways filtered itself down to even current thinking about religion and spirituality. It's also the case that mental health professionals are abnormal. And when I say abnormal, I mean that in the statistical sense, that mental health professionals are unlike those that they serve. In the U.S., for instance, there's a sharp religiosity gap between the religious orientations of mental health professionals and the general population. As you can see on this slide, within psychiatry, psychiatrists, about 56% would state that their religion is fairly or very important. That compares to 90% of the general population in the United States. In the U.S., 96% of the general population says they believe in God. For psychiatrists, the percentage is 73%. For clinical psychologists, the percentage is closer to 25%. I could go on, but the point is that practitioners in this area are very unlike those that they treat. And I think because we as mental health practitioners tend to be different when it comes to religion and spirituality, less religious and spiritual, we may underestimate its importance in people's lives and turn our attention away from it when it does arise. It could also be said that spirituality represents a competing worldview from that of science. We can see in this slide a different set of values that are articulated within the world of science, where we speak of pragmatism and replication and skepticism, in the values and language of spirituality, where we hear the language of faith, revelation, intuition, compassion, and so on. Now, certainly, I think these languages can be bridged, but it is the case that oftentimes when people from spiritual and scientific communities try to talk, they talk against each other, or they speak in a different language and just fail to understand. Maybe the most important reason for the tension between spirituality and mental health has to do with spiritual illiteracy. The fact is that within the mental health professions, training in the area of religion and spirituality is pretty unusual. For instance, in one survey of psychiatrists, 65% said that they received very little spiritual training. 65% said that religious and spiritual issues were never or rarely discussed. In clinical psychology, only 15% of graduate programs in clinical psychology offer a course on the topic of religion and spirituality. So avoidance, antagonism, skepticism, competition, illiteracy, these aren't the best qualities for integrating spirituality into behavioral health care. But they are realities that we need to anticipate and respond to if we're to move towards greater integration. Well, why should we? Let me shift gears here now and talk about a few good reasons why spiritually integrated mental health care makes such good sense. First, religion and spirituality are embedded in many cultures. For instance, in the United States, over 147 million people are members of religious congregations. In a survey conducted in the United States, 58% of Americans reported that they pray daily, 74% reported that they believe in life after death, 68% said they believe in angels and demons, and so on. Now, taken as a whole, these indicators make a really important point, and that is that religion and spirituality are cultural facts. People see the world through a sacred lens. Many speak the language of faith. Many take well-established religious pathways over the course of their lives in search of spiritual goals. So practitioners can ill afford to overlook the role of religion and spirituality, given their place in the lives of many people. Another reason why integration makes such good sense, spirituality is a resource for so many. In times of greatest stress, people often turn to their faith for help. We've conducted many studies on the roles of religion in coping among combat veterans, divorcees, widows, physically abused people, and so on. And the findings are consistent. Many people look to their faith in times of deepest stress. More rigorous studies have also yielded evidence of positive links between faith with physical health and mental health in times of stress. For instance, in a study by Tepper and colleagues, they found that 80% of people with serious mental illness coped through their religion, and 65% found it helpful. These findings held true for caregivers of people with serious mental illness. One study showed that 90% of family members caring for loved ones with schizophrenia coped through prayer, and 50% found it helpful. And in the most extensive review of the literature to date, Harold Koenig and his colleagues have linked the majority of studies of religious involvement with a number of indicators of well-being, such as self-esteem and hope and optimism, purpose in life, less loneliness, less depression, less drug and alcohol use. Now, it could be said that maybe these religious and spiritual resources are merely indicators of more basic secular resources that just are clothed in sacred garb. Is there anything that religion and spirituality offer distinctively? Well, I'd say yes. Empirical studies have shown that spiritual beliefs and practices, such as support from God or a religious community, predict health and well-being over and above the effects of general factors such as social support and general coping. And at the institutional level, religious congregations, we know, have a distinct access to minority, marginalized, and disadvantaged groups. The average person in the U.S. is more likely to turn to help from clergy than from other professionals, including physicians and counselors. So it's a good reason why we should be locating health prevention services and programs within religious settings and collaborating with religious communities to offer this kind of service. Well, having said that, there's a flip side to the same coin. And it's also true that religion and spirituality can be a source of problems. Paul Preuser, the psychologist of religion, once said that there's a seamy side to religion. We can find examples of religious extremism, religious prejudice, hypocrisy, guilt, passivity, and they all can have their religious and spiritual roots. And religion and spirituality can create their own special brand of tension and conflict, struggles over sacred matters, with God, within oneself, with other people. For instance, I'm putting a slide up here that just describes the pain that one student, an undergraduate, experienced with God in coming to terms with her bipolar illness. And you can hear in her words the deep conflict and strain and tension she's experiencing with God, questioning why God would allow her to experience such upheaval and emotional roller coaster in mood. Spiritual struggles of these kinds are not uncommon. In one study of patients with advanced cancer, Tracy Balboni and her colleagues found that 58% reported some kind of spiritual struggle, such as wondering why God allowed the cancer to happen, feeling abandoned by God or angry at God. Now, these problems are important because they can be tied to all kinds of distress, including anxiety, depression, PTSD, even greater risk of mortality. Harold Koenig and I conducted a study in which we linked spiritual struggles not only to greater risk of decline physically and psychologically, but greater risk of mortality in medically ill elderly patients, even after controlling for a variety of confounding variables. In particular, feeling abandoned by God was a predictor of greater mortality over 2 years. This was the first study to show that spiritual struggles can, in fact, increase the risk of dying. Now, whatever form they may take, religious and spiritual problems are sources of great pain, and they do call for a response. Another reason for integration of spirituality into mental health care is that patients, people, generally prefer spiritually integrated approaches to care. The lack of attention to faith matters among mental health professionals doesn't seem to come from disinterest on the part of those we serve. It may have to do with our own reluctance. Several studies indicate that patients would prefer to be able to talk about religious and spiritual matters with their physicians and counselors. In one study, only 18% of patients in counseling centers said they prefer not to talk about issues of spirituality and religion in counseling. Other studies have shown that medical patients have unmet spiritual needs. Again, one study by Balboni and her colleagues found that 72% of patients with advanced cancer felt that their spiritual needs were minimally or not at all supported by the medical system. 47% felt that their needs were not supported by their own religious communities. And unmet spiritual needs, we're learning, can have a high cost. For instance, unmet spiritual needs at the end of life have been tied to more aggressive use of medical care and higher end-of-life costs, particularly among minority patients. Spiritually integrated interventions have also shown promising results, so more spiritually sensitive care may have real benefits. For instance, in one study by Avance and his colleagues, they compared a spiritual form of therapy to help drug-dependent and HIV at-risk people to a non-spiritual form of treatment. This treatment, called spiritual self-schema therapy, or 3S therapy, was designed to help people access their spiritual selves, in other words, their higher selves, through various resources. And working with these patients, they found that this therapy was tied to significant decreases in the use of illicit drugs, according to not only self-report, but drug-free urine tests, and it also helped them shift their conception of themselves from being addicts to being spiritual beings. Spiritually integrated treatments have also outperformed secular treatments in some instances. Finally, we should integrate spirituality into practice because we're ethically obliged to. Ethical codes of virtually every healthcare discipline require the members of our mental health professionals, mental health professions, to attend to religion and spirituality as contributors to human diversity. Last, we should integrate spirituality into mental health care because we really don't have any choice. Spirituality is a part of mental health care. No matter how we may try to remove ourselves from religious and spiritual issues, it's impossible to be neutral about these matters. Freud talked about being a blank slate in working with patients. But there's pretty good evidence from psychotherapy research that therapists do, in fact, shape the outcome of psychotherapy in part by the values that they bring to treatment. Patients tend to move towards the values of the therapist in treatment. So the danger, if we try to leave our values at the door, is in failing to recognize the subtle ways our values may impact treatment. And to focus on secular issues in therapy doesn't mean that the spiritual issues aren't continuing to unfold and affect the process of treatment. In short, there's some solid, empirically based reasons why our field is beginning to integrate spirituality into mental health care. Religion is embedded in many cultures. Spirituality is a resource to many people, but it can also be a source of problems. People prefer spiritually integrated approaches to mental health. Evaluations of spiritually integrated interventions are showing promising results. Spiritually sensitive care is ethically mandated, and we can't really disconnect spirituality from mental health care. So maybe the key question isn't why should we integrate spirituality into mental health care? Maybe the key question is, what's taking us so long? I hope these brief comments have been helpful to you. And again, I wish you well in your conference and that this is the beginning of a fruitful collaboration between the United States and Cuba in the area of spirituality and health care.